Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Ned Bazzini, has written a novel. Well, it could be for any age. If you've got a son who's 14 or 50, he's gonna love it. And yet you yourself will enjoy the fact of the fantasy part of it. The book is called The Other Normals, and it's published by Balzer and Bray. Welcome, Ned.
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. I mean, because you read this and you're taking me to another world.
It was something that I always wanted to happen to me as a young man. I grew up in New York and I would wish that the subway doors would open and I would be in a jungle or a forest. And it never happened, so I decided to make it happen with this book.
Well, let's talk about Perry. Because Perry's parents, I mean, the whole concept of Perry's parents, each of them remarried to the lawyers who handled their original divorce.
Yeah, I like writing about uncomfortable situations, and the idea of your mother dating her divorce lawyer and him eventually taking on the case pro bono, and your father ending up with his divorce lawyer, it appealed to me. I also like the idea that this divorce has been going on for years and years, so it's like a Dickensian court case. You know, all of the participants are dead, but the case continues on. So that's Perry's situation at the start.
And it also allows Perry's mother, father, and friends to discuss Perry and what they should do about his puberty, in a way.
Perry is a late bloomer, and all of my books in some way concern people who feel out of touch with the other adolescents around them. I think it's a universal and powerful emotion to start from with a character. I was a late bloomer. Late bloomer is one of those phrases that sounds innocent, but it's really very scary. You're worried that you're never going to become the adult that everyone says you're supposed to be. You're worried that something is wrong with you. And Perry's worried that something's wrong with him, and increasingly the adults around him are also worried about it.
And he has a brother, Jake. Now, Jake is a musician who is hot with the girls, and he's into anything, really.
Yeah, I played in bands in high school and college, and so that character of Jake, the guitarist who walks with a real strut and has his act together in a way that's self-destructive, but that he makes look easy, that's a character that I know. I knew people like that. And like Jake, things didn't turn out too well for them.
But with Perry, his whole life really is into a game. Mm-hmm. And it's a game where he can play other parts and leave off the Perry who nobody talks to at school, or whose only friend is a guy named Sam.
Mm-hmm. When I was 13 years old, I started reading these Dungeons and Dragons books that I loved. They were full of charts and rules, and you could make characters and you could go to a different world. And a game much like this in the book, it's called Creatures and Caverns, not Dungeons and Dragons, is what envelops Perry. And his friend Sam is the person who unexpectedly loves that world too. And so together they can really play this game that takes them to a different place.
And lo and behold, his parents get together, and instead of letting him go to school for the summer, they say, we're sending you to camp so you can become normal and one of the gang.
Yes, and
horrors.
I went to summer camp every year starting when I was 7.
I hated camp, so when I read this book, I had a sister who was always being voted best all-round camper, and with me they called my mother and said, take her home, I don't think she's going to be well.
You beat me, I never got that call. I had a bad time, but they never told my mom to come get me.
You didn't have hay fever.
I didn't get really sick. I was always at this level at summer camp where I got made fun of and I had a difficult time. There were always one or two people lower on the totem pole than me, so I could feel that I didn't have it as bad as it could be.
Yeah.
But summer camp is very difficult for kids because there's no schoolwork to distract you or to excel at. It's all social. It's all sports and friends and who you know. And the kids can be very vicious and it can be very Darwinian. And my parents sent me to one summer camp where I was pretty out of place in terms of my skin color. I was like the only white guy in the summer camp, and I wanted to write about a situation like that.
And it is. And Sam, who turns up to be at that camp, says, listen, don't talk to me. If I can, I'll say something to you, but I don't want these people to know you and I are friends. Across the lake is the girls' camp.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly, after going to, he goes into the woods
mm-hmm.
without clothes.
Mm.
And he finds himself in, as the book shows, the other world of the normals.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how did he get there?
The world of the other normals is an alternate reality. And in order to invent it, I read a lot about multiverse theory
yeah.
and this idea that we live in a universe that has many parallel universes running next to it. Now, the world of the other normals is a world like Earth, but about 600 million years ago, it split off and it developed on its own. And these amazing creatures evolved yeah. there and a whole society grew up. And now, for a couple of hundred years, Earth and the world of the other normals have been back in concert.
Yeah.
And if you do the right thing involving a car battery and some mushrooms that are stashed in the woods, you can travel to the world of the other normals. And that's what Perry does.
But he never knows when it's going to happen.
Right.
Yeah.
he meets a spirit guide type character named Morton Enaw, who brings him,
yeah.
and he never really knows when he'll be called to action.
Yeah. Now, he has had a fight with a guy named Ryu.
Ryu.
Yeah, who has said, as he's hitting him, I'll get my gang after you and we're gonna kill you.
Yeah.
And they're not kidding.
Yeah, that's based on my high school experience. I went to Stuyvesant High School in Manhattan. I think I can talk about this now. There was a student there who will remain nameless.
Unless he's in the book.
Well, he's who Ryu is based on.
Yeah.
And he was an unassuming Asian kid. He dressed very flashy. And he would just always make fun of me for various things. And it really got on my nerves. And one day, I got fed up. He spat on me while I was on the stairs, and I whirled around and I hit him with my backpack, and he fell down the stairs, and then I jumped and I started kicking him on the ground. I mean, I really lost it. It was one of those moments when I resorted to violence. It happens very rarely. And he got up and he said, I'm gonna get my gang and I'm gonna kill you.
And he wasn't kidding.
And he wasn't kidding. He yeah. was in a gang called the White Lotus Crew or something at my school. And I started just leaving school a little earlier than I had yeah. to. I didn't cut classes. I didn't have an eighth period class. So I just skedaddled out of seventh period because people told me that he was actually gonna get me. And a couple months later, he shot a cab driver as part of a gang initiation and was sent to prison.
Happiest day of your life.
I was removed from the situation at that point.
Perry, who now is also calling himself Peregrine?
Well, his real name is Peregrine. Just like my real name, my birth name is Edison. And he doesn't like to go by Peregrine because he thinks it's yeah. dorky, but as he discovers himself in the world of the other normals, he thinks maybe it's the right name for him.
Yeah. How'd you get the name Ned then?
When I was a baby, my mother just started calling me Ned, and everybody called me Ned. And by the time I was six, I was writing Ned on the school forms,
yeah.
but my name was technically Edison, and it got very confusing. And so they went to the city hall and they changed my name legally to Ned,
yeah.
which involved a big stack of papers. So it has officially been Ned now for a long time.
There's a woman too, because our friend Perry, there's a girl, Anna, whom he would love to know.
Mm.
She is beautiful. She is everything he wants. And finally, I do think it's very funny that he finds one pubic hair finally.
Yeah, that's the part of the book that I think some people get uncomfortable with because it's very personal, but it's real, and I couldn't avoid putting it in there. The fact is, when you're a young man and you're a late bloomer and you're worried about becoming an adult, and you get the first little hair, that's an exciting moment. Yeah. And I wanted to put it in the book.
And who are you going to tell if you can't write it down?
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Now, in the world that he's in, the other normal world, he also gets involved with almost like wars and fights. And he's protected in a way by Morton.
Yeah.
And Ada. Mm-hmm. Describe them a little bit.
Morton is human-ish. He has red skin, he has yellow hair, he has a tail. I like to think of him looking a little bit like Robert Downey Jr. And he has a bit of a problem. He's addicted to smoking pebbles, the pebbles that you find everywhere on Earth, anywhere lying around, just anything with quartz in it. He gets a little bit of a high when he smokes them, and so he has a bit of a addiction to these pebbles. Ada is his assistant, his intern,
yeah,
and she has blue hair, pale skin, sparkly toenails, but she's very much a badass as opposed to a damsel in distress. She kicks butt, and Perry likes her for it.
I would love them to hear you read a little bit. This is a chapter where you're describing some of them.
Okay.
Set the scene, if you will, Ned.
I actually think it was set just from what I was saying.
All right.
Ada bangs her fist on Morton's chest. What is wrong with you? You can't smoke in here. He's going to come back and get us. So, he's just trying to look tough. I'm not going to let him push me around. The door slams back open. Ryu enters with Gamari. Gamari is a centaur. Look at that, Morton says. We were just talking about you two. Sorry, I know no smoking. I'm putting it out now. I got a little carried away. He dumps the pebbles on the ground and smiles. But Gamari just points at him, a deep distance in his expression. That's him, officer. Three monsters enter the room. They're all hybrid other normals. Ingresses, I remember Ada called them. The front two are men from the waist down, or at least from where their legs come out of their loincloths. And fish creatures above, with scaly chests, spindly arms, fins sticking out of their backs, purple bulbous eyes, and jagged teeth. They wear belts with handcuffs hanging off. Their stench hits me like rotting fish and beached seaweed as they stand at attention with spears. The best I can say for them is that at least they're upfront about being monsters. The third one is more subtle. He's a human from the waist up. If he held your gaze, you'd think he was just a dour man with a thick, dark mustache. But his lower half is composed of thick, slimy octopus tentacles. He makes puckered, sucking noises against the wood as he approaches. He's the leader. The other two stand still as he moves. He's shirtless, wearing a long burlap skirt, a kilt, I correct myself, underneath which his tentacles bloom. He has a lantern-jawed face, brown hair, and controlling eyes. He rotates his palm on the hilt of a conspicuously large sword as he looks at Morton, Ada, and me. Morton Enaw, you and your associates are under arrest.
Yeah. Then they go to jail, and they do, I forget how they broke up because it's a little complicated, but they do break out